weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk. Let me walk close to thee.
Yes, to speak closer along and then finish.
Yeah,
close to the one that's new.
Welcome to worship. You are worshiping with Trinity United Methodist Church in Hutchinson, Kansas. My name is Kim Beery, and I serve with our senior pastor, Pastor Michael Thompson DeGrief, and in the name of the Lord, we welcome you. Please take a moment to fill out the red attendance register in your pew and pass it on down to your neighbor. We'd like to highlight a few ministry opportunities, which include the signing up for Vacation Bible Camp. This is your last day, so make sure you sign up any children that you know for this wonderful learning and fun experience. Our Trinity Treasures they're having an art show this week. So put on your calendar next Sunday. Make sure you go up and down the hallways, down by the office, so you can see our future artists. Today also, you can sign up for the United Way Workday, which will be a Saturday, August 28th. Sawtalk Community Support will be part of our special offering next Sunday, the 25th, as we support students in need in our high school and middle school. And then also, a potluck's coming up. And so know that you are invited to this great time at 11:45 in Thorn Hall on August 15th. So come, let us worship our living God through music, prayer, message, and God's presence.
Please stand if you are able and join in the call to worship. We have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God.
Just as I am, I come, O Lamb of God.
We have been saved by your amazing grace.
Freely I have received your love, so freely I will give.
Please continue standing as we sing.
Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will, while I am waiting, you will instill. Have thine own way,
and join in the people's prayer. O God, source of all that makes life possible, giver of all that makes life good, we gather to give you our thanks, yet we confess that we have often failed to live our thankfulness. What we have, we take for granted, and we grumble about what we lack. We have squandered your bounty with little thought of those who will come after us. We are more troubled by a few who have more than by many who have less. Forgive us, O God, in this hour of worship. Accept our thanksgiving and teach us to make gratitude and sharing our way of life, through the grace of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Prayer is part of a living relationship with our God. It's a time to listen, a time to talk, a time to connect maybe in new ways, and to share the journeys of our brothers and sisters in Christ. For we know that there will be times in our journeys where we need a little extra help. There will be times when we fall in this slimy pit of depression and can't get out without prayer. So as we gather together as a community of faith, this is a powerful time together. Please note that you can share several of your prayer requests in different ways. There is a prayer card that you will find in the pew that you can fill out and put in the offering plate. Pastor Michael and I are both available before and after the services if you have something to share. And you can see on the bulletin there are prayer requests and joys listed. I do want to highlight that Doug Foss is back home and awaits another procedure next week. Also, we want to add to the list Travis Boo, who's going to have a knee surgery on Wednesday. So as we lift these folks up in prayer, know that our God hears, listens, and wants to connect with you. Let us prepare for prayer. God of grace and mercy. Whether we're lifelong laborers or new arrivals in your vineyard, we know you value us just as we are. Forgive us when we quibble over perceived little injustices. We look around us and see mercy being offered to others when we feel that they have done little to earn such treatment. Give us eyes to see where justice and compassion may be offered. Give us hearts to reach out to those who are new in the faith and who struggle in life. Hear now the prayers of thanks and concern that we now speak silently in our hearts. Living God, shake the dust of arrogance from us and nourish us with humility and joy. Help us be the kind of disciples that serve you faithfully, Lord. Remind us of your faithful presence as we remember the words that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please join us in a sweet hour of prayer. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer that calls me from a world of care and bids me at my Father's throne, makes all my wants and wishes known. In seasons of distress and grief, my soul has often found relief, and oft escaped the tempter's snare by thy return, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, the joys I feel, the bliss I share. Of those whose anxious spirits burn with strong desire for thy return, with such I hasten to his place where God my Savior shows his face, and gladly take my every prayer and
Good morning. Are there any children here that would like to join me for children's time? And Chris is going to help too. I'm here. You guys are here too? Oh, great. Great. Hi. Welcome. How are you today? Good. That's good. So today, Pastor Michael's going to share with us the parable of the workers in the vineyard. That's a big name. Wow. So we've heard lots of parables lately. Do you remember what a parable is? I mean, that's a big word right there. Do you know what a parable is? You don't? Chris, do you know what a parable is?
Is it a story?
It is a story. It's a story that gets told in the Bible, and it teaches us a different lesson. And we got to read it, and you got to interpret what the lesson is.
Okay?
So today, Pastor Michael's got his parable. He's going to read what's in the Bible and talk about that. We're going to kind of do this a different way because we're going to put it in, you know, words and language that we understand it, okay? A little twist. So I'm going to need your help. Can you help me? Can you help me?
I'll try.
Okay. I'm going to need you to stand up, okay, on the flat ground, okay? So I want you, can you do jumping jacks? You can, right? Oh, of course you can. Okay. Okay. Stop. Okay. So can you do like 10 jumping jacks? Okay. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Awesome. Chris, that was really good. Really good. Like, there's no way I could do that. Anyway. Okay. So Chris, can you give me 2? Okay. Okay. 1, 2. Oh, good job. I'm so proud of you all. Okay, Chris, you did so good. Let's see here. I got a couple starbursts for you. You get 2 starbursts. She did 2 jumping jacks. She has 2 starbursts. Okay, you did so good too. Guess what? You get 2 starbursts for doing yours. So you did how many jumping jacks? 10. Chris, and you got 2 starbursts. You got
2 starbursts because I did 2.
2. Oh, you each got the same number. You can sit down. You each got the same number of starbursts, right? It didn't matter if you did 10 or you did 2 jumping jacks. You got the same number of starbursts. In God's eyes, each of you is the same. It doesn't matter if you do a lot of jumping jacks or just a couple. God loves you. Okay? So this is kind of like the same as if you are out at the store and you see different people there. God loves everybody there the same. And people at school, the kids in your class, God loves everybody in your class and wants everybody to treat everybody the same. Okay? He loves all of us. Okay? That's the moral of the story. So when Pastor Michael's talking in some bigger words, just remember, God loves everybody. I'm not saying you're going to use really big words, but we gotta put it in words that I understand, okay? That God loves everybody. Can you pray with me? Dear God, please help me to remember that we are all valuable and all loved by you. Amen.
There's a lot about grace in today's service, and this is a song that God gave me a few years ago on grace, so we'll do that for you now.
God, you sent your Son to save us, Jesus Christ will not forsake us to death and life. You give us hope now, humbly we bow to you, O God. We give you thanks and praise you, this earthly home we've been sent to find your will, so we may follow and show to all your love, O God. I live our life for thee, because it sets us free.
sometimes through sin we fall, but somehow through it all,
you love us still.
God, you sent your Son to save us. Jesus Christ will not forsake us to death and life. You give us hope now. Humbly we bow to you, O God. We give you thanks and praise you, this earthly home that we've been sent to find your will, so we may follow and show to all. Me, that I might show your awesome love for all to know through daily life, time after time, your saving grace is mine.
We love you, God.
God, you sent your Son to save us. Jesus Christ will not forsake us to death and life. You give us hope now. Humbly we bow to you, O God. We give you thanks and praise you, this earthly home we've been sent to find your hope, so we may follow and show to all your love, O God.
The scripture reading today is from Matthew 20, 1 through 16. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into the vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3, he did the same. At about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more. But each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "The last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day in the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I chose to give to this last the same as I gave to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
It's funny when the Holy Spirit gives you something to say right before you get up to say it. Good morning. It's good to be with all of you. It's been nice to have a little time off. If you didn't know, I was on vacation with my family, and I missed all of you. It's good to be back with you. We went out to Colorado for a bit. It was lovely. And went to St. Louis to see my father, who I haven't really seen much since my mom passed away last year. So it was really a wonderful time with my family, and I appreciate the gift of that time off. And I just have to say, I'm really enjoying your music, Hazel and Eric and Eldon. Do you guys go by the Idlewood Trio? Is that your name? Aren't they doing a fantastic job? It's really great. really a blessing. Well, so today is the seventh sermon in the series on parables. Kim and I have been diving into these complicated stories. Every week she goes, "Why'd you give me this one? I don't know what to do with this one." And that's kind of how I feel too. These parables are challenging, and that's what I really enjoy about them. And I've gotten some good feedback from all of you that you're enjoying the parables as well. You know, Jesus, his disciples even, were perplexed by parables. This is what it says in Matthew 13. The disciples came and asked Jesus, "Why do you speak to them in parables?" And Jesus answered, "To you it has been given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been given. The reason I speak to them in parables is that in seeing they do not perceive, in hearing they do not listen, nor do they understand. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and blessed are your ears, for they hear." Let us pray. God of power and grace, may we hear these familiar parables with new ears and with open hearts, so that your word may enter our lives and produce fruit worthy of your kingdom. Amen. So we were covered from head to toe in silver metallic paint. And it wasn't just any paint, it was oil paint. It was sticky and it was stinky, and we were all hot and sweaty from working all day long in the scorching summer sun. It was awful. As a young man, I was a professional painter for Davidson Painting Company in high school and college. Every summer I would paint. And for most days, it was a pretty good job. But that day, one of the painters, Terry and I, had been assigned to paint this long chain link fence that went all the way around a playground and a soccer field as part of a renovation project for a grade school. We had two power rollers. I don't know if you know what power rollers are. They look like regular rollers, but they're hooked up to a really loud machine that makes noise all day long, like, so you got that in your ears, and we're hot and sweaty and sticky. And we're on each side of the fence. Terry's on that side of the fence. I'm on this side of the fence. And we're slowly going up and down with our rollers, trying to be in sync, like a mirror, so that we can get this thing done in one day. We didn't. But we were very careful. But even though we were being careful, the paint was splashing all over us. And we were getting covered in this metallic silver oil paint. The electric pumps had filled our ears all day long, and we were covered in paint, and we just looked pathetic. The other painters would come out on break just to laugh at us and take pictures and mock us. That's how ridiculous this whole thing was. But that was my lot in life, right? I was a student. I just worked part-time in the summer, and I was at the bottom of the pecking order, right? The very bottom was the student part-time painter. I was always stuck with the grunt work, the things nobody else wanted to do, right? The messy jobs. But I always did what my boss told me to do because I was getting paid, right? I had a boss who used to say, "That's why we call it work and not play. I'm paying you to do it, so shut up and do it." Good thing to remember. So I was getting paid $6.50 an hour, which was twice minimum wage at the time of $3.25. So actually, it was a good job for a teenager in the 1980s. Now, you can imagine my dismay when I discovered that Terry, the other guy I was painting with, was getting paid three times what I was getting paid. He got $21 an hour as an apprentice painter in the union, and I got $6.50. Now, how can that be? Terry was only a couple years older than me. He wasn't faster. He wasn't stronger. He wasn't a better painter than me. Yeah, he was a full-time apprentice, and I was just part-time summer help. But still, the disparity stung. Jealous anger welled up inside me, and I wondered, did my coworker really deserve to be paid more for doing the same job? That doesn't seem fair, does it? I think that's part of the power of this parable, is that even though it's 2,000 years old, it still resonates with our human nature of wanting things to be fair, right? It taps into this primal feeling of jealousy and envy when someone else gets something that we feel we deserve, right? This, our sense of self-worth, a sense of wanting to get paid what we deserve. And so the parable starts out simple enough. It just says the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. after agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage. And my Bible has a note, the daily wage was 1 denarii. And then he sent them into the vineyard to work. The landowner goes back to the marketplace again and again throughout the day. So just so you follow the story, he started at 6 in the morning and he went till 6 at night. It's a 12-hour day, right? He went and hired some people at 6, then he went at 9, then he went at noon, then he went at 3, then he went at 5 with only 1 hour left in the day. 5 different times. It's actually very puzzling. I wonder, is the landowner hiring all this labor because he needs the labor? Or does he see these people who want to work and he just feels bad for them? Because I've known a lot of shrewd business people, and hiring somebody out of pity is not good business practice. I think it's strange behavior. And then at the end of the day, he does something else strange. The landowner lines up the people who had worked all day long, and he starts with those who only worked an hour, and then he lines them up to the people who worked all day long. And so the people who worked 1 hour, he hands them a denarii, and then 3 hours, denarii, 6 hours, denarii, 9 hours, denarii, 12 hours, denarii. Everyone got paid the same. That doesn't seem fair, does it? Barbara told me, I hate this parable. Yeah, I get it. And then it says, those who were first, the ones who worked 12 hours, they thought they would receive more. Yeah, I think they should. But each of them also received 1 denarii. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, these last only worked 1 hour, and you've made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat. Seems like a pretty reasonable complaint to me. Would you agree? Yeah. But the landowner replied to one of them, friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? You know, certainly the landowner can do whatever he wants with his property and his wealth. But economically, this parable is a mess. If someone who works 1 hour gets paid the same as someone who works 12 hours, it takes away the incentive to work hard all day, doesn't it? It messes with our heads. Giving something valuable to folks who don't deserve it. That doesn't seem fair, does it? It doesn't seem fair, does it? Okay. Unless this is an allegory, it's trying to reveal a deeper spiritual truth to us. Perhaps this is a key for unlocking the mysteries of the kingdom of God. If God is the landowner and we are the laborers, then the point of the parable is that we all receive the same salvation, regardless of how long we serve the kingdom and regardless of how deserving we are. God distributes grace generously and extravagantly and lavishly to everyone. Regardless of who you are or what you've done, you are redeemable. God's love and acceptance is available to all without condition. Yes, yeah, some don't get it, some don't care, and they still get grace anyway. That doesn't seem fair, does it? Some people waste their inheritance on reckless living, and when they run out of money, they come begging back to their father who embraces them. That doesn't seem fair, does it? Some people fail to love God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength, and yet they receive eternal life just the same as those of us who have spent our entire lives loving and serving the Lord. That doesn't seem fair, does it? But let me ask you something. Does it seem fair that an innocent man died so that you could live? Does it seem fair that Jesus suffered and died on the cross for your sins and for my sins? Does it seem fair that salvation is offered freely to everyone when it came at such a high cost? Christ gave his life as a ransom for many, and what could we possibly give in response to the gift of his life?
What seems fair to you?
As we share in our offering today, let us remember that whatever our struggles, whatever our miracles, whatever our burdens, whatever our fruitful labor, we are thankful for the blessings from God and from God's good creation. As signs of that gratitude, let us offer now our tithes and gifts during this time. May you be blessed as you give.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me.
Let there be peace on earth, a peace that was meant to be. With God as our Father, brothers all are we. Let me walk with my brother in perfect harmony.
Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now.
With every step I take, let this be my solemn vow.
To take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Praise God from rangers here below. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, the source of all our gifts. Praise Jesus Christ, whose power uplifts. Praise the Spirit, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Please join me in the offertory prayer. Almighty God, giver of every good and perfect gift, teach us to render to you all that we have and all that we are, that we praise you not with our lips only, but with our whole lives, turning the duties to sorrow, the joys of our days into living sacrifice to you, through your Jesus Christ. Amen.
Join us in the closing hymn. Be not dismayed, whate'er the tide, God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day. Through day.
danger fierce your path assail, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or on the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you. All you may need, He will provide. God will take care. Nothing you ask will be denied. God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day along the way. He will take care of you. God will.
Thank you for being here this morning. I hope you have a wonderful week. Let us bow our heads and pray for God's blessing. What we have said this morning with our lips, may we truly believe that in our hearts. And what we believe in our hearts, may we put into practice in our daily lives by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The test. God will take care of you. The weary ones upon His breast. God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you.
Oh, when the saints
go marching out.
Oh, when the saints go marching out. Oh, Lord, I want
to be in that number when the saints go marching out.